addition to being, I'm an assistant professor of English and Creative Writing here at St. Augustine University. But in addition to that, I'm also a professional artist. Poetry, performance art, theater, music, also a professional writer. So my lens of thinking about popular culture comes from being on the side of academically looking at how these things exist, but also as an artist, looking at artists struggling with how to present these things to the world and their ability and opportunity to be able to get that out there. So when you talk about social media, I'm a part of conversations regularly of artists saying, this is what's out there, this is what they're promoting, but this is what we're doing. And we want people to know that we are doing something that they don't talk about. So when these conversations happen where, you know, folks are like, rap music is just bad, horrible, and hip hop is dead, it's like, there's a million artists who have messages in their music who are like, no, we're not dead. Like, I'm out here every day, like, trying to promote my music to the masses, and you see four videos, and you're like, it's dead, this is horrible. Like, no. Same thing with visual art, same thing with poetry, same thing with videographers and filmmakers. So the first thing we're going to talk, how many people know who Rick Ross is? Beautiful, it's going to be really easy. One of the interesting things, this is the month of love, the love in Black history. I had a conversation where I asked if you look like Rick Ross in a tank top, walked up, but he sounded like Langston Hughes, Cornel West, and Louis Farrakhan, would he get the number? That was the question. And there was a resounding yes. Surprised me. But it was the value of intelligence over appearance. And but was interesting to hear that dialogue. But I say that to say that Rick Ross has become a polarizing figure in popular culture. Now, he released a song called Aston Martin Music. Yes, the song was titled after a car. It was Chrisette Michelle, who was very popular at the time, was in the song. And then, of course, everybody's punching bag for popular culture and Black identity, Drake. Everybody loves to either love or hate Drake. It's amazing. It's amazing the conversation that sparks behind Drake. They released this song. Now, what we're going to look at is we're going to look at the beginning of the video, because the video was amazing to me. We're going to look at the beginning of the video up to a certain point. All right? Hopefully we'll get, you know, there's not a lot of whole language or whatever at the beginning. We're going to look at the beginning of the video. So I'm going to play the video, and I want you to just take in. All right? If you like the song, try not to get caught up. I need you to just pay attention to the video. I don't want to, once that beat drop, I don't want you to close your eyes like, ah, get this. But we're trying to go, right? I need you to just stay with me for about a minute into the video.
That's my car. That is my car.
Ooh.
That is my V8. That's my car.
Ricky, you ain't never gonna get that car.
Don't worry, you're gonna get that car someday, Ricky.
Balls.
Gets this, you know, this Black guy, sort of looks like Rick Ross growing up, maybe a little slimmer. He gets out. There's a woman who gets out the other side. They walk into the house. Everybody, that's my car, Aston Martin. There's a little kid sitting on top of a car. He says, I'm gonna have that car. There are two young ladies sitting there. One says, you ain't gonna get that car. The other one says, yeah, Ricky, you gonna get that car. Now, what nobody ever notices about the beginning of this video, whenever I point it out, is just that quick, in the first 30 seconds, what is being said to us in that moment? How much can you unpack about that moment? What is being said to us in just... Dark-skinned women are not encouraging, right? She gave him the neck roll and everything, like, you ain't getting that car. Who then tells him he's gonna get the car?
The light-skinned with the good hair.
Yes, the light-skinned girl with the good hair, right? And then what does the little kid look like? He's a chubby little dark-skinned kid who sees a chubby dark-skinned man get out of the car and walk in the house with what?
A light-skinned girl.
A light-skinned, long-haired, curly-haired girl. Okay? So automatically you have this image in your mind from the beginning of this video that talks about colorism and what's appropriate, what's beautiful, and what makes sense. So here you go. Thank you. I appreciate that. So there's this narrative about masculinity and femininity, black masculinity and femininity, that plays out in the beginning of the video, off gate. And it's funny because whenever I point it out, nobody really pays attention to the beat drops. They see the car come in, Chrisette Michelle. Nobody ever, like, I never pay attention to the beginning of the video. Like, as soon as the beat drop, then they pay attention. But then, let's examine that for a minute. Let's look at that. If you watch the beginning of the video, especially if you've seen it before, it starts off with them riding in the car with the young lady, because when he grew up, he got a what? A light-skinned woman, right? As his girlfriend. He's in the car, he's driving to Aston Martin, they're going shopping, right? Okay. He's walking out, he sees his girlfriend being approached by police. She gives him the subtle nod, like, right? Then she gets arrested. In your mind is the implication that either there's something in the car or somehow they're associated. So at that moment, she becomes what type of girlfriend?
Ride or die.
Yes. Yes. And there you go. It, now you're being told, that's what I'm talking about right there. I mean, my girl, she ride or die. Right? Go to jail for me. You know? Forget that I did wrong. You ain't had nothing to do with it. But to allow me to continue to be who I am and be out here in these streets, I need you to take the fall and go to jail for me. What happens in this video gets deeper, because when she gets out of jail, he shows up. Anybody who's seen the video, when she gets out of jail, what's the first thing they do when they get out of jail? He picks her up, and then next thing you see, they doing what? Balling. They balling. Baby, you held me down, so you know what? You let me be out here on these streets. I'm about to give you everything you asked for. I'm gonna pick you up in the Aston. We're gonna go. We're gonna ball out. I buy you all everything you want. All you gotta do is ride, die for me, hold me down, right? Forget, we don't know if she got any dreams or aspirations, if she got any goals, was she a college student? She could have been a PhD in biomedical technology. We don't know. All we know is that when it hit the fan, the drug dealer stays out, she goes to jail for however long, and she gets clothing when she gets out of jail. That's the narrative that we get.
That's good.
All right? That's the narrative that we get. So what does that say? Like, what gets lost in that? So it starts off with this whole thing about color, not only in terms of the women, but in terms of him. I showed this video too. I had this conversation with a group of young men who were actually on their way here as freshmen. And one of the larger dudes in the room was like, oh, well, this let me know that big men, you know, big men can get out there and get it in. Automatically, is the first thing, his own self-image about growing up, being a young, chubby, dark-skinned, that's the first thing he saw. He ignored everything else, but he saw a big dude who ends up with, in his mind, a beautiful woman and a car, and the first thing says, all my issues, I might have been picked on, might have been chubby, all that goes away because I have something to look to. Never mind the fact that by playing to that self-image, he's been fed all these things that shouldn't be appropriate about black relationships, about love, and about priorities and morality. Right? You with me? Beautiful. That's what I'm talking about. That's the first conversation. Next conversation we're going to have. How many people know who Dave Chappelle is? That's what I'm talking about. Y'all know, we all know Dave Chappelle walked away from Comedy Central, right? They he said it was at the moment where they did the pixie sketch, which I feel bad about laughing at after I heard him talk about how he felt that he was going too far. He left $55 million contract. Next thing you know, he's in Africa. Everybody said he was crazy. He lost his mind. Maybe he was on drugs. How could you leave $55 million? He starts to unpack this idea of crazy. This concept of crazy has been attributed to lots of entertainers and artists, regardless of culture, ethnicity, but in terms of black people, it becomes a very, 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 very insightful thing to call black people crazy, depending on how they react. When you speak out and speak for your people, they call you crazy. It's a way of devaluing what you're saying. When you may be under pressure to do certain things you don't want to do, how that manifests ends up getting you called crazy. We've heard Lauryn Hill be called crazy. Dave Chappelle was called crazy. And he speaks about Martin Lawrence and the situation that happened with Martin Lawrence, where they were saying Martin Lawrence went crazy. And he says, it's one thing, we love tragic stories, right? But in the same sense, we love to watch people crash and burn. And then when they crash and burn at the end, we're like, oh man, oh. Like, it's amazing how there was this period of, we love Whitney. Whitney's wilding out, and she just says she's too rich to use crack. Whitney Bobby jokes, Whitney dies a year later. Oh my goodness, Whitney's the greatest. Oh, we just love Whitney. Y'all didn't love Whitney a couple years ago. Y'all watched her fall apart. And we're gonna do the same thing with Cat Williams. Y'all watched her fall apart. Jimi Hendrix, Cat Williams. I mean, we watch them fall apart, then they're beloved when we lose them. So, I want y'all to watch this clip.
And Lawrence was in that chair. We talked about Blue Streak.
I love it.
He played a role in your life, I believe. How do you feel about him as a person, as an artist?
Martin Lawrence is the guy that showed everybody you can make it from D.C. to Hollywood. And I had a personal stake in his success. Every time he did something, it made me feel inspired and really good. And he was always real nice to me. He'd sit me down, what's going on with you, baby boy? What? We'd talk about comedy, whatever. And, when we did Blue Streak, we were promoting it, and Martin had a stroke. He almost died. And then after that, I saw him, and I was like, oh my God, Martin, are you okay? And he said, I got the best sleep I ever got in my life. It's how tough he is. So let me ask you this. What is happening in Hollywood that a guy that tough will be on the street waving a gun, screaming, they are trying to kill me.
Yeah.
What's going on? Why is Dave Chappelle going to Africa? Why does Mariah Carey make a $100 million deal and take clothes off on TRL? A weak person cannot get to sit here and talk to you. There ain't no weak people talking to you. So what is happening in Hollywood? Nobody knows. The worst thing to call somebody is crazy, is dismissive. I don't understand this person, so they're crazy. That's bullshit. These people are not crazy, they're strong people. Maybe the environment is a little sick.
And then probably a cigarette. But there's a couple of subtle narratives there. One is about, strength and perceptions of strength. To have a stroke. And then, like, even though he was like, he used it to talk about how strong Martin Lawrence is, there is something, if you can see it in your grandparents. My grandfather just had a heart attack. Nurse came, checked his blood pressure, it was high. He told her he called the ambulance, he called the hospital to check in after she left. He didn't. 3 days later, he watched a Super Bowl Sunday, he eating pork rind, McDonald's. He had a heart attack. There's something about this idea of him having a stroke and being like, man, that's the best sleep I ever got. Like, I'm good, it's okay, it's nothing. And you go back to work. Go right back to work, right? So this perception of how do you handle mental health? How do you handle physical health as a black male? Like, are you supposed to be showing weakness? And do you show weakness to your fellow men? Like, do you have a circle of men? And these are two people who are really close, right? But he didn't pull them to the side and be like, man, I'm struggling. I don't even know how I made it through all that. That's not the best thing I ever got. I'm good. How often do we see folks who are really hurting, but they're like, oh man, it's nothing, I'm good, man, they can't, you know what I'm saying? The quickest thing we love to do is be like, oh, man, I just hate it, man, it's nothing. Nah, it is something. But then on top of that, he talks about the idea of calling someone, how dismissive it is to call somebody crazy. Mm-hmm. How many of y'all have in the last 2 weeks called somebody crazy? Right? We just call people crazy. We love to do it. I've had friends who called their significant other's nickname was crazy. Right? Literally, crazy calls you, like, man, I'm sorry, you know I can't do that, man. Crazy gonna go off. Literally called her nickname was crazy. But what that is it is dismissive, and it's a term that's used in a lot of different ways. For him, the term was used to allow him in front of his male counterparts to say, I really respect her feelings, and I know that she wouldn't approve of me going to do that. So he can't say that because he's never going to hear the end of it. So he said, yo, you know she's crazy, right? You know I can't go do that. She's going to lose her mind. No, she ain't going to lose her mind. You're going to sit there and tell her I really wanted to be here instead of with my friends, and y'all are going to have a good evening. But to us, she's probably wilding out. Yeah, man, you know how she get. Yeah, she did. She y'all sat and you snuggled up and ate food and watched TV. You just don't want your boys to know. But this idea of crazy, the same thing happens. We use crazy to also dismiss people who are being affected by their surroundings. All right? Lauryn Hill has been trying to tell people she's been going through things.